Mr. Taru, in this video, we are going to continue our discussion of integrating, working with integrals that involve trigonometric substitution. Our previous video, full-length lesson, has four examples introducing this process and working through four, some pretty complicated examples. So I'll put a link in the description below. Here we have really a problem here that's not going to be too difficult to work out, but it is going to be an example that help you understand how to deal with those lower and upper limits, or those definite integrals. And there's two ways to do this problem. The first way is kind of just go off to the side and work it out as an indefinite integral, and when you're finished, go back then into references of x, bring in those lower and upper limits of 4, and then finish the problem up. That's going to be the first way we do this this example. Then we're going to remind you that the second part, or the second way of working this problem out, is, of course, we're not going to go off to the side and write an indefinite integral. And the purpose for that is, when we get done with our trigonometric substitution, we're going to remove all references of x and put in references of theta. Well, I can't write a definite integral with references of theta with the same lower and upper limit of 0 and 4, because those are in terms of x. So if you like, you can, and it's preference, whatever you prefer. But the second way, we're going to go ahead and put those lower and upper limits also in terms of theta and finish the problem that way. And of course, we'll have the same answer regardless of, you know, how we do the problem, unless we make a mistake. Okay, so we have a square root of a sum of squares. All of, we had some integration rules that had a square root of a difference of squares. Those involved, I'm looking over because my green board's over here, integration rules involving inverse trig functions. But here, with a square root of a sum of squares, we're probably going to need to redo trigonometric substitution, unless we can take the derivative of the inside function and get some kind of expression that's going to be, we can work with that numerator. Well, if we let u be x squared plus 16, then du is equal to 2x, that's a degree of 1, but our numerator has an x with a degree of 3. So we will need trigonometric substitution. And you recognize that, again, by seeing that you have some kind of square root of a sum or difference of squares. Well, we have in our denominator a square root of x squared plus 16. And so our Pythagorean theorem, of course, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. The hypotenuse would be c is equal to the square root of a squared plus b squared. So this expression is going to be the hypotenuse of our right triangle. And if that's the case, then we need to recognize that from this expression, u is going to be just equal to x, the square root of x squared, and a is going to be equal to the square root of 16, which is just 4. Now, where do you put that x and that 4? I talked about this in my full-length video as well, but if you didn't watch that one, do we put the x here and the 4 here? Do we put the 4 down here in the horizontal or the adjacent leg and the x in the opposite leg? Well, when you start setting up your trig substitution, you want to set up one of your primary trig functions, sine, tangent, or secant. You don't want to set up one of the cofunctions like cosine or cotangent, or cosecant for that matter. So if we put the x down here and say the tangent of theta is equal to 4 over x, well, we want to make this process go as smoothly as possible. We want that denominator to be the constant. And I don't want to do the cotangent of theta is equal to x over 4, because I don't want to work with those cofunctions. So I want to work with the primary trig functions. So we're going to let x be up here, the square root of x squared, and 4 be our adjacent leg, and then we have the tangent of theta is equal to x over 4, multiplying both sides by 4, and we have x is equal to 4 times the tangent of theta. And then dx is going to be, well, the derivative of tangent is secant squared, so we have 4 secant squared theta d theta. Okay, so looking back at our integrand, we have a substitution for x. It's going to be 4 tangent of theta. We've got our substitution for dx. It's going to be 4 secant squared theta d theta. But we don't have a substitution yet for our radical. And again, we want to set up some trig function where the constant is the denominator. So we're going to have the, well, let's see here. We have r, or the hypotenuse over the adjacent side. That is going to be what? I've got trig stuck in my head too, so r over x is going to be secant. So we have the secant of theta is equal to the square root of x squared plus 16 over 4. So the square root of x squared plus 16 is going to be equal to 4 times the secant of theta. Fantastic. So now we have a substitution to remove all of these references of x, but again, I want to do this first process by just doing the indefinite integration that we learned in our previous lesson. And then when we finish that indefinite integration process, we're going to go ahead and go back into terms of x and then take care of those lower and upper limits of 0 and 4. So we're going to just come off to the side and say, say, well, we're going to have the indefinite integral of x cubed over the square root of x squared plus 16 dx. We have the indefinite integral of x cubed, which is going to be 4 tangent of theta cubed over the square root of 16, of x squared plus 16 is 4 times the secant of theta. And then we have a dx, which is equal to 4 secant squared. Okay, we have common factors, and you might want to put this over 4 so you see the 1, so you see the numerators and the denominators line up. Our common factors of 4 are going to cancel out. We have a common factor of secant theta is going to cancel out one of those two secant thetas, and we're left with the indefinite integral of 4 cubed is going to be 64, and I'm going to bring that constant out front. Tangent theta cubed. And our secant theta d theta. Now we're just going to work with this indefinite integral, with it sort of recognizing that we have an integrand that's just involving trig functions and powers of trig functions. Since the power of our tangent is odd and positive, we're going to save a secant tangent factor and put everything else remaining into powers of secant. So we're going to have our secant raised to some power. That's going to be sort of like our u raised to a power, our inside function, and then du would be that secant tangent, that factor that we're going to save because the derivative of secant is secant tangent. Now that is all review of skills that we've already learned just a few sections ago. So I'm going to go ahead and step off, reveal this solution one step at a time, and also make sure my handwriting is all neat and it fits on the board. And you can pause the video and make sure that you can finish this on your own. So we have completed our integration process through the indefinite integral, and we have the indefinite integral of x cubed over the square root of x squared plus 16 dx is equal to 64 times 1 third secant cubed minus secant theta minus secant of theta plus c. Writing the plus c, of course, because I worked this through an indefinite integration process, but we're not doing an indefinite integral, we're doing a definite integral. And again, if in this line I had kept a reference of a lower limit of 0 and an upper limit of 4, well then I would have an integrand referencing theta and x at the same time, and you just don't want to do that. Well, awesome. Now we know, so the definite integral from 0 to 4 of x cubed over the square root of x squared plus 16 dx is equal to 64 times 1 third secant cubed, secant theta cubed. Ah, wait a minute. I'm about to write secant of theta cubed minus secant of theta and use those lower and upper limits, or write those lower and upper limits of 0 and 4, but I have an integrand referencing x, and our lower and upper limits are in terms of x, and I'm about to write an expression that uses in terms of theta. You don't want to do that. It's 1 third times secant of theta cubed. Well, secant of theta is the square root of x squared plus 16 over 4, and that is all cubed, minus, again, secant of theta, now that we have the references of x back in there, we can use our lower and upper limits of 4 and 0. Now I'm just going to write this out and finish cleaning up the arithmetic. And I'm going to make sure that when I plug in my lower limit of 0, I include, of course, with that minus, and maybe I might even want to do this. This is when I'm plugging in my 4 minus. Now, when I plug in my 0, that's going to remind me that I need to distribute the negative if needed, or to simplify all that work in the second parentheses and not have a sign error. Okay, let me just step off and clean all this up. Alrighty then, so cleaning up all that arithmetic, we get a definite integral which is equal to 64 times the negative square root of 2 over 3 plus 2 thirds. Fantastic. What if you didn't want to go through the process of removing these references of theta and putting this whole problem back into references of x? What would that look like? Well, let's just pick up with this line right here, which says that we worked out, you know, we're looking at this, we want to keep the lower and upper limit, we've done all our trig substitution, and we're down to this line. Now I want to write this line, but I want to use those lower and upper limits of, well, I want to have my lower and upper limits in terms of theta. I don't want to go back into references of x. Well, let me just say, it's going to look like this. So you're going to want to say, I'll tell you what it's going to look like, and this time, correctly, it's take two. We have the definite integral from 0 to 4 of x cubed over the square root of x squared plus 16 dx, and we already understand through the process of doing it with the indefinite integration that we have this equal to 64 times a definite integral. We're going to have some new lower and upper limits though. 64 times the definite integral of tangent of theta cubed times secant of theta d theta. But how do we come up with those new lower and upper limits? Well, we again have references of theta, references of x in terms of x. How do we have this, you know, what is the simplest equation over here that's going to relate the variable of theta to the variable of x? So it's right there. The tangent of theta is equal to x over 4, and that is the equation we're going to use to rewrite our lower and upper bounds into terms of theta. So we have the tangent of theta is equal to x over 4. We want to write that so that we can find theta. Right now it's stuck inside of a tangent function, so of course theta is equal to the inverse tangent of x over 4, and that is going to allow us to come up with a new lower limit. That is going to be theta is equal to the inverse tangent, plugging in what was our lower limit of 0 over 4, the inverse tangent of 0, you know, within our restrictions of negative pi over 2 and positive pi over 2, so that that inverse tangent function is acting, well, as a function. And the angle measure, you'll see here, what was that tangent function again? It starts at negative, well, the center period starts at negative pi over 2, comes up, passes through the origin, 0, 0, and then approaches infinity as the graph approaches pi over 2 from the left. So the inverse tangent of 0 is going to be 0, and our upper limit will be that theta is equal to the inverse tangent of 4 over 4, plug in what was our upper limit into this little conversion formula. The inverse tangent of 1 is going to be pi over 4. And when you probably ran into this when you were doing your definite integration with U substitution. Sometimes when you take your lower and upper limits and you put them into some new variable, before being maybe in terms of U, now in terms of theta, sometimes what you plug in what was the lower limit and you get a number that you're defining as the lower limit, and it is the lower limit, sort of. If that lower limit ends up being bigger than the upper limit, you would place those appropriately on your definite integral symbol. Then you have to swap the places, because this does need to be, you know, the lower limit needs to be a smaller number. And of course, when you swap your lower and upper limits, you change the sign of that integrand. But we don't have that issue here. Our lower limit is still going to be zero, but our upper limit, in terms of theta, both of them, is going to be pi over 4. Excellent. So now our integral, or integrand, is all written in terms of the same variable. And we want to integrate tangent cubed times theta times secant theta. Well, we've already done that. We know that the answer is equal to 64 times 1/3 secant cubed theta minus secant of theta. Now, we don't need to plus C, of course, because we're doing a definite integral. So we have this is equal to 64 times 1/3 secant cubed theta minus secant theta, with our upper bound of pi over 4 and our lower limit of 0. And I'm not using, of course, I'm not writing secant of theta is equal to the square root of x squared plus 16 over 4, because I have my, again, lower and upper limits in terms of theta. I don't need to go back in terms of x. So we have 64 times 1/3 secant of pi over 4 cubed minus secant of pi over 4 minus 1/3 secant of 0 cubed minus secant, I keep almost writing the theta there, minus secant of 0. Of course, just plug in your upper limit and then your upper lower limit. Now, the secant of pi over 4, secant is the reciprocal of cosine. The cosine of pi over 4 is square root of 2 over 2, so the secant of pi over 4 is just simply square root of 2. The secant of 0, the cosine of 0 is equal to the 1, and secant's a reciprocal, so the secant of 0 is also going to be 1. And when you get done, you know, simplifying this, you'll have the same answer that we had before, of course. It is just a different way of doing the same material. And, you know, that is the end of my example. If you want to deal with, or if you're working with definite integrals and you realize that you're going to do a trigonometric substitution, you have the option of, again, coming off to the side and just doing that indefinite integration process. When you're done putting those theta expressions back in terms of x, and then you know, finish it that way, or just simply change your lower and upper limits and put them in terms of theta. And I think the end of the problem is certainly going to go a little bit quicker. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.